Problem four, let gamma be a semicircle with diameter AB. The point C lies on the diameter AB, and points E and D lie on the arc BA, with E between B and D. Let the tangents to gamma at D and E meet at F. Suppose that the angle ACD is the angle ECB. Prove that the angle EFD is the sum of the angles ACD and ECB.
So this is the configuration. We're given a semicircle, gamma, but I don't like semicircles. I much prefer circles because there's more theorems about them. So I've taken the circle gamma we were given on diameter AB, and I've extended it to a full circle, and I'm going to call the whole circle gamma, not just the top half. We've got these two points on the circle, D and E, and tangent lines at D and E, which meet at F. In this case, F is, as it were, on the right-hand side. It could be that D's down here and E were up there, and F would be over here somewhere. You get a slightly different diagram, but if you reflected it, you reflect the picture about the axis of symmetry going through the centre of the circle that way, you could get to this picture. So this is actually a general version of the diagram. I don't have to worry about other possibilities. Right, now what you like to do with geometry problems, if you want to solve them easily, is to just chase angles. There seems to be a bit of a problem. We want to bring circle theorems and stuff like that into play, and we can do that if we regard this bottom semicircle as being the reflection of the top semicircle. We do that reflection, D will come down to here, let's call it D dashed, and we'll have a line DC reflected to the line D dash C. Now it looks as though that's a straight line, but we don't know that yet. In fact it is, but we'll get there. Because this line segment reflects to that line segment, they have the same length. We can join D to D dash, because that's going to be useful later. Now what's going on here? Well, CD has reflected to CD dashed, so that angle must be another copy of X. Now let's look at what's going on here. You probably know that if you've got two straight lines meeting, then you have vertically opposite angles, and they're equal. Here it's kind of the other way around. What's happening is that you have a straight line AB, and a line EC, and a line CD dashed, but the angles here are equal. So you can use converse of vertically opposite angles to say that, oh, actually, this is a straight line. E, C, D dashed is a straight line. Very good. Now, what can we do? Over here, we've got an isosceles triangle. It's got apex C and base angles D and D dashed. Well, the angles, the base angles of an isosceles triangle are equal, and the angles of the triangle, C, D, D dashed, must add to 180. The only way that can happen is if the two base angles are each 90 minus x. So 90 minus x plus 90 minus x plus x will be 180. 90 minus x is a bit of a lot big thing to write, and you often call 90 minus x the complement of x. Now, I'm going to draw in another line. I'm going to draw in the chord DE. There's something interesting going on here. We have a tangent line to a circle and a chord. That means the theorem about angle in the alternate segment is in play. The angle FDE should be equal to the angle DD dashed E. Oh, that's fine. So that angle there is X complement. And for exactly the same reason, over here, the angle DEF will equal the angle D d dashed e, that will also be 90 minus x, the complement of x. And that forces this angle here to be 2x, because the angles of triangle FDE have to add up to 180. This is 90 minus x, that's 90 minus x, so that has got to be 2x. But that's exactly what you want. The angle EFD is the sum of the angle ECB and the angle ACD. And that's a complete solution. But I'm not going to stop there, I'll show you another method. So here's a second approach. The condition that angle EFD is the sum of angle X and angle X is equivalent to saying that angle EFD plus angle DCE add to 180 degrees. Now there's a famous result that says that a quadrilateral is cyclic if and only if opposite angles sum to 180 degrees. So somehow there ought to be a circle passing through those four vertices. We don't know it exists yet, but, well, let's see. It sort of seems to, and it seems to hit the diameter about here. And when you look at it, well, it looks rather like, I'll call it O, the center of the circle. And in fact, that is going to be the case, but we don't know that yet. So I want to conjure this circle into being. I can't say it's the circle through these five points, because I don't know that works. I can't even pick four of the points, but I can pick three of them and define a circle through three of those points and then hope that it goes through the other two. So I have to show that. So which three points to choose? And I don't really think it matters very much. I am going to work with C, E, and D. So I'll draw a circle now, but I don't know that it passes through F, and it's going to cut AB somewhere, but I don't know that it's going to cut it at O. So let's have a look at how that might work. So I've drawn this green circle. It's going to pass through F, but we don't know that yet. And I'm saying that it crosses the diameter AB at the point O dashed, which later on we will realize is O. But anyway, defining this point to be O dashed means that it does definitely lie on the green circle, and we have a cyclic quadrilateral, O dashed C E D. So let's draw in the sides of that cyclic quadrilateral. Right, now what's going on here? C, E, D, O dashed is cyclic. This angle around here, that's O dashed C, E, is the supplement of X. That's 180 take away X. Opposite angles of a cyclic quadrilateral add to 180, so that forces this angle up here to be X. Now I'm going to draw in another diagonal for this cyclic quadrilateral. Now I'm going to use angle in the same segment. Our chord is going to be D O dashed, and that's going to subtend angles in the same segment. It subtends the angle O dashed C D, and it subtends the angle OED, and those angles have to be equal. So X is up there. Now let's look at the triangle O dashed ED. It has two angles equal, both X. So it's an isosceles triangle with apex at O dashed. Well, when you have an isosceles triangle, the perpendicular bisector of the base goes through the apex, doesn't it? So the perpendicular bisector of this chord will go through O dashed. But the perpendicular bisector of a chord of gamma is actually a diameter line. So O dashed lies on this diameter of gamma. But it lies on a second diameter because it lies on AB. Now, two different diameters intersect at the midpoint of the circle. So O dashed can come out now, it can stop hiding, it's actually O. It is the center of the circle. And we've made significant progress. Now, what about F? We want to bring that into play. Well, angle FDO is a right angle because DO is a radius of gamma and DF is tangent to gamma at D. So we have a right angle FDO. Similarly, we have a right angle OEF. So, the circle on diameter OF must pass through both D and E by the theorem about an angle in a semicircle is a right angle. So the circle on diameter OF passes through D and E and O and therefore C. Oh, so that circle must be the one that we've been working with all along. The green circle actually passes through F. And this clinches the deal, because now we know that FDCE is a cyclic quadrilateral. Its opposite angles, EFD and DCE, add to 180. But so does DCE plus 2x. And that forces this angle EFD to be 2x, which is exactly what you wanted. And so we've proved it. Now, I expect there'll be trigonometric methods to solve this problem and all sorts of other ways. There are certainly ways to do it using methods from projective geometry. But the point is, there are these accessible direct Euclidean solutions. I hope you enjoyed the problem.